Hello everyone. This week we start with some very sad news as Jason Pierce, the modder also known as Spartan Mods, died in a tragic car accident along with one of his children. I didn't know Jason personally, but I knew of his work. But seeing the outcry of grief from his friends and from the whole of the modding community over the last week has been very moving, and I thought it would be remiss to talk about modding without mentioning Jason, known to be one of the nicest, most fun guys that you would ever meet, and extremely generous with both his time and knowledge in helping other people, both experienced and new modders alike. Unfortunately, his wife and other child were also involved in this accident and are currently in hospital in intensive care, but both in a stable condition, although critical. Unfortunately, unlike here in the UK and America, people have to cover their own hospital costs, and some of his friends have started a GoFundMe page to help with the medical bills and funeral costs. If you would like to donate to that cause, the link is in the description below. Rest in peace, Jason. As well as all the kudos and acclaim that come with such a title, the winners, as chosen by you, will also win some Hydro X water cooling goodness, very kindly provided by Corsair. First place will win their choice of an XC7 or XC9 RGB CPU block, a GPU block from Corsair's range, an XD5 RGB pump res combo, and a Commander Pro. Second place will get to pick a CPU and GPU block, while third place gets their choice of an XC7 or XC9 CPU block. If you'd like to take part and be in with a shout of winning some of these awesome Corsair goodies, all you need to do is put a project log of your mod up on the BitTech forums. Once it's marked as completed, it will be eligible for that month's competition. Now let's get to the builds and see what modding glory we have for you this month. We'll start with the winner of the previous mod of the month for May. Now you may remember that Alessandro, our newest member of the team, was in the running for that award. But as he's now staff, he's graciously withdrew so that others may benefit. So in first place we have Ikagi by Nick Falzone, then WoodDesk 2.0 by MA Modified in second, and in third Tranquilum by Terhorst Customs. Long-term BitTech members will be no stranger to Alan's work, although it has been quite some time since he last wielded a Dremel in anger, but his last project, Tristellar Whetstone, was Mod of the Year in 2015. No pressure then. Alan started by constructing the component drawer from 2.5mm aluminium sheet, cut and bent into shape, and then wood strips screwed round the front and side faces. A combined motherboard and GPU tray was constructed from the same aluminium, using a scroll saw to cut sections out to lighten the tray and add cable routing holes, with aluminium and acrylic supports being made to then hold the GPU and riser in place. The fans for the radiators would mount directly to the bottom of the drawer, with holes cut for the fans using a massive hole saw. However, the ports of the rads were to face downwards, and to do so he'd need to raise the radiator slightly. So spacers were made from scrap acrylic that was cut, glued and shaped to fit between the fan and radiator. And this is why you keep scraps. A small aluminium bracket was then cut and bent to fit two bulkhead fittings, which hold copper pipe runs to and from the radiators, securing them in place above the hardware. While waiting to see if he got lucky in the GPU lottery, Alan turned his attention to the desktop itself. Having cut the desktop and supporting pieces to size, he first marked and routed holes for them to be connected using oblong dowels, as well as some pocket holes for screws. Then in the top left corner of the desktop, He removed some material from the underside and then pushed all the way through to make some ventilation slots, to which he would fit some slim fans to exhaust the heat from the radiators. A small access hatch was also cut into the top near the centre of the desk, with a lipped edge and cover made to fit into it, giving access to the front IO, which would be attached under the desk with a hand-cut aluminium cover. Alan then attached some stainless steel table legs using threaded inserts embedded into the top, and once constructed, he then oiled the wood to bring out the grain in the rubber wood, hevea being the Latin name for the rubber tree. One of the coolest tricks Alan pulled was in creating a hinged cable arm that attaches to the back of the component drawer and stretches out when the drawer is opened. As the cables are attached to the length of the arm, there isn't slack being pulled in and out, which can get caught and snagged, and is an ingenious solution to something I wouldn't have considered until I was routinely pulling the power cable out. To finish off, the aluminium of the component tray was painted black, and the remaining copper tubing runs were bent to shape and polish, then sent to be nickel plated. Meanwhile, an LED strip was attached to the back of the desk for a nice ambient glow. I'm so glad Alan chose not to add a window, as the uninterrupted desktop looks fantastic, and it's easy enough to pull the drawer out to look at that chromed goodness inside, especially with his trick cable arm. I also love how he's added drawers across the whole front, which gives it nice symmetry and also gives it more functionality. You may remember NeoFatch's water-cooled PS5 mod from February's Mod of the Month, but not content with just a water-cooled PS5, he decided to kick things up a notch or 12 and combined it with a fully water-cooled ITX rig as well. Starting with a BitsPower Touch Aqua Summit CPU block, he discarded all but the cold plate and made a new one-piece top incorporating all the coolant channels and mounting points. This then attaches to a tall GPU-style acrylic terminal, so the tubing can be routed above and behind the motherboard into the custom distro, the distro being attached to the back of a central aluminium spine to which all the hardware attaches to. All of the blocks and water cooling components are connected with very short straight runs or extenders, so all the mounting points and the ports in the central spine and distro have to be incredibly accurately measured, designed and machined to ensure they fit, as there's very little wiggle room with such short straight runs. To the left of the hardware are two DDC pumps, and while in operation they're fed from the distro, a single tall flat reservoir would later be attached across both acrylic tops in order to fill the loop. These are connected to the pump top inlets only using a sealing O-ring, so getting sufficient but even tension across both the pumps was critical to ensure they didn't leak. Returning to the hardware side, a 3080 with a BitsPower block would be secured above the motherboard, as the tubing runs for the CPU block would go through where an ordinary riser cable would be, a custom one with separate wires that could fit around the tubes was made. To assist in the PS5's integration with the rest of the mod, the mono block went through several iterations until its new final V2 version, with nickel-coated blocks, an integrated temperature and flow sensor, and multiple inlet and outlet points. The particular version chosen for this mod has black mesh between the two layers of acrylic where there are no coolant channels, and along with the frosted side of the bottom piece nicely hide the PS5's PCB underneath. The Blu-ray drive is secured behind in the rear section, along with the two PSUs, one for each system. Custom silver power cables then flow throughout the centre to where it's required, and two thick 360 rads were installed above this. These connect directly to the distro with extensions and push fittings. The CNC'd aluminium case panels along with the central core are all painted black, and for those little extra touches, power buttons for both systems were constructed using keyboard switches and machined LU buttons, which were also then painted black. These sit in the top panel along with the front IO, and there's even an eject button for the PS5's Blu-ray on the side by the drive too. With the short tubing runs painted black and using black fittings, it hides all but the components themselves and illuminates the blocks even more. It almost gives you the impression that they're completely isolated from one another, maybe even floating within the case. It's quite an impressive feature, and you'd really struggle to detect anything connecting them when looking through the large window that covers them. As well as being quite the engineering feat, the system looks absolutely flawless. Nessa is another Mod of the Month regular, and comes to us this time with a case mod based on the Asus Z11 ITX case. Whilst not the smallest ITX case at 40 litres, it only has capacity for a single 240 red. So what do you do when you want more? More! Their solution was to create an exoskeleton which would act as a pedestal for the case, as well as holding a thick 360 radiator. The majority of the outer frame was constructed from a single piece of CNC cut 4mm steel, which was then bent into shape in a heavy duty brake with a smaller piece for the feet. As well as holes for the radiator fans, it also has holes for the bottom intake and top exhaust of the case, and for the water cooling tubes to pass from the radiator through the frame and into pass-throughs in the top of the frame and case. Not wanting to leave some plain old boring holes in the steel, covers were made for the ventilation by using CNC cut aluminium frames, which would then sandwich 3D printed louvres against the steel skeleton. The case was then painted orange and black, with the frame just in orange, but when combined with the black radiator and fans, it repeats the colour scheme of the case. The aluminium louvre frames were left in their raw silvery finish, which, along with the silver water cooling fittings and black coolant, helped blend the rig together with the black and silver components. A new back panel for the case was also CNC'd from aluminium, with a rectangular cutout into which sits the Seasonic Connect unit and shows it off nicely. A small pump res distro was made to fit into the case's rear fan bracket, with routes to extend the loop to the GPU in the future. But as he didn't know what GPU he would end up with when designing the mod, and the Strix cooler already fitting the theme so nicely, it was decided to leave it air-cooled. The mod was finished off with some cable mod PSU cables, which are mostly grey and helps lighten up the interior a little. An aluminium cover for the SSD with a Viper head logo was added, and a similarly styled nameplate was placed below on top of the PSU shroud. The finish mod delivers on its name and does have a frog-like stance, despite not really sharing any of a frog's more familiar features. It's a very nicely thought out and designed mod, and has been executed really well to tie the frame and the case together. I especially loved the look of the louvres and how they were constructed. Serial modder Mayhem Mods is back once again with a Call of Duty Warzone theme mod, based on the newer Vision Z2. They started by breaking down the case and coating every surface inside and out with a custom camo paint job, building it up layer by layer using twigs and small branches to create the pattern. With the case prepped, he began on the fabrication, starting with a new rear cover panel. This was made by building up several layers of acrylic, with a Modern Warfare cutout in the centre, and when painted with the same camo pattern as the case, he uses vinyl stencils to leave an unpainted Call of Duty Warzone lettering, which would later get LED illumination. Next up was a PSU shroud, and as the case doesn't come with one as stock and relies on the PSU getting its air from inside the case, it included a fan cutout to make sure it could breathe. This is still a high performance machine after all. This then had another layer added to the top and side with an Aorus and Warzone motif respectively, and then painted in the same camo pattern. Another multi-layered acrylic construction was then created to mount three SATA SSDs to the right of the motherboard over the side fan mounts, with the whole lot treated to the same camo paint job, SSDs and all. The SSDs also get Aorus Eagle logos, and another illuminated layer is added to the top of the section with a Mayhem Mods logo. The top and front also acquired their own camo painted illuminated logo panels, then the closed loop cooler, GPU, motherboard and RAM all get that same camo treatment, with the latter three also getting a myriad of Aorus decals. Any high performance rig isn't complete these days without a lightning fast M.2 drive, and Gigabyte make one of the most beautiful heatsinks for their Aorus PCI Gen 4 drives. A solid block of copper milled with fins, and there's no way he'll be painting that. Wait, he's not painting that, surely? Not the copper? Yep, even copper can't escape the camo, and it hides itself among the components like the predator lying in wait. Not content with just modding the case and internal components, the keyboard, mouse and headset are also set about too, with camo, decals and illuminated logos. However, on discovering the headset couldn't be taken apart without damaging and he was limited on what he could mod on there, he made a camoed stand for it, complete with LED base. The finished mod looks amazing. The light of the LED panels is nice and evenly dispersed, and it provides a bold and powerful look. Just don't put it down in a wooded area, or you may never find it again. Open air skeletal cases are all the rage at the minute, with chassis available in a range of sizes from the compact ITX Hydra Mini to the colossal Atlas 2. FreeCase lands somewhere between the two, as while it's big enough to take a full-size ATX board, it's barely any taller or deeper, and not very wide either, only enough to cover the PCI brackets and an upright PSU behind the motherboard. After a quick mock-up in cardboard and some careful CAD work, despite having no prior experience in CAD, it's comprised of just two pieces of aluminium, which were outsourced to be cut, bent and anodized. There's an 8mm thick piece for the motherboard tray, with a 2mm piece for the rear panel, housing rear I/O, PCI brackets and the PSU, the rear piece being secured with screws down the spine of the motherboard tray, with the thickness of the central piece and the brace across the back forming a triangle, it didn't even require any feet. The PSU at the back also counterbalances the components in the front nicely and makes it very stable. To get the power cables to match the case, it was time for some custom wiring. And I'm not talking about sleeving or extensions either. Their PSU isn't modular, not even hybrid modular. So it required desoldering the original cables and then soldering on the new 1.5mm black cables, which have been cut to custom lengths. The raw unsleeved cables really suit the look of the minimalistic chassis. The chassis was so stripped back that there wasn't even a sniff of front I/O, not even a power button, relying on the onboard switches of the Corsair 6 Hero. After spending some time with it in this state, this was addressed though, with a rather smart wooden base with a power switch on one side, with USB and audio ports on the other. This then has aluminium plates bent over the top and front to cover the cutouts for the cables. This then has aluminium plates bent over the top and front to hide the cutouts for the cables. It's a really neat, tidy and clever mod, proving the old adage that sometimes less is more. With a book full of notes on improvements and tweaks to be made, Goran is already working on version 2. With the case to have a blue colour scheme, the obvious choice would be to go with a blue case. So of course Alien started with a Corsair Spec Omega in red, obviously. It wasn't red for long though, and after stripping the case into its component parts, he painted the coloured panels blue with some plastic dip, and then removed the glass window section in the front panel and replaced it with black steel mesh. This would improve ventilation for the 360 radiator going in the front of the case and also mirror the ventilated section in the roof. The interior was up next as new plexiglass panels were made to cover up the right hand side of the motherboard tray and a new single clean PSU shroud. These would be given a triangular trapezoidal motif that mimicked the pattern of the plastic support structures in the front and roof. To make this effect, the pattern was hand cut into black vinyl, which was then applied to a white plastic sheet, which was then in turn attached to the new plexiglass panels. With LED strips installed in the side of the plexi, the white plastic sheet helps to diffuse the light more evenly across the new panels. A custom water cooling loop for the CPU was then installed, with a neat little fixture plate made to mount the pump res to the hard drive cage, and a matching blue and grey 24-pin extension was used, which passes through the new section next to the motherboard. The GPU was to be mounted vertically, but the Cooler Master bracket he had set the graphics card too far back in the case for his liking. So this was modded with another section added to the back of the bracket to push the GPU forward, and a hole cut in the rear of the case for the new GPU position. Whilst pushing the GPU to the side panel is normally a bad thing for air-cooled cards, a new side panel was made out of a large sheet of plexiglass, which was then laser cut with the same polygonal design as the rest of the case. So the GPU still has access to plenty of fresh air. Using the same pattern for the mod already found in the case works really well, and it looks stunning, with or without the lighting on the new panels. You can vote for your favourite mods on the Discord channel or on the BitTech forums. Make sure you check out the project logs for these mods, as they are crammed full of details that we don't have time to cover here, and you'll really get a full understanding of just how much work has gone into these mods. And you never know, you might find inspiration for your very own. Again, if you'd like to take part and be in with the chance of winning some fantastic Corsair Hydro X gear, you just need a completed project log on the BitTech forum. But please get them in from the start of the project, as it's fantastic to see them progress. And if you ever run into a problem and you find yourself stuck, you've got the BitTech community at hand to help you through. If you're new to the channel, welcome. Don't forget to subscribe, as this is the home of PC modding on YouTube. We've plenty more project logs, part reviews and tutorials coming up, and you don't want to miss out on any of that. You can also follow us on Facebook, Instagram and Twitter for all the latest tech news and reviews, links of which will be down below, where you'll also find a link to our Discord server. You can come there and chat to us about mods, builds, tech, or just shoot the breeze with a sympathetic ear. Be sure to also check out our merch store link below, where you can pick up some sweet t-shirts, hoodies and a BitTech mug for your morning cup of joe. So that's it for this mod of the month. Until the next one, you take care, folks, and I'll catch you then. Same bit time, same tech channel. See you then.